Previously in Hedge Knights, Megu instructed Tangier on how to safely operate the mineshaft. The main gate for the curtain wall was plotted out so that work towards its construction could commence. Megahoof worked on transcribing manuals for armorsmithing for Lazarus. Tangier extracted iron from deep under the foothold keep. Giant white bears blitzed into the keep and were repelled by the squires. The first of the Mackey harvest allowed Sappho to prepare meals for travel. Episode 12, Salix. The Adlets of the Bison Glade spent their day laboring over the farm fields and masonry projects. Megahoof asked the masons to prioritize building an enclosed perimeter because his next research project would require him to leave the safety of the glade, and he wouldn't feel safe doing so unless he knew everyone else was safe. Dave had been recuperating within the toxin-free walls of the keep, but he felt well enough to aid Judea and Tangier so that Megahoof could depart on his pursuit before winter set in. Otherwise, his departure might be postponed for another season or two, and the Adlets needed help with pollution urgently. Soon the keep would be overflowing with mackie and wheat. The farmers let everyone know that more shelves to store grain and vegetables would be needed. The mackie was already starting to rot in the fields. The issue would need to be addressed at once. The keep started to look like an intricate maze of shelving for food and textiles. The squires couldn't wait to share their bounty with friends and family on the coast. The wheat was nearly ready to be harvested, introducing grain back into the Adlet diet for the first time in likely centuries. Megahoof had given Sappho the manuscripts about milling and baking, many of which describe milling grain by hand as grueling. But to further his knowledge of the ingredients he worked with, he had asked Megahoof for a millstone. He wondered if the ancestors of the Adlets were lazy or labor-averse, or possibly the quantity of grain needed to feed a kingdom was an insurmountable obstacle. Either way, he was very pleased Megahoof had uncovered schematics for a windmill in case milling grain was brutal. Both Sappho and Lazarus made the call not to attempt to sow any more of the precious ancient seeds, as it was both quite unlikely they'd manage to harvest another yield before the early autumn frosts, and also they were already running out of food storage, and the new crops didn't spoil nearly as quickly as the fungus they had previously relied upon. Megahoof worried about the crops rotting in the field and would join the other Adlets who weren't already busy constructing the walls to haul the newly harvested crop to the pantry and keep shelves. Bash asked his dad if he could be the one to name the newest bison, and Megahoof scratched his beard and wondered what sort of name his kid would come up with. Stereotype, Bash said, and the name bewildered Megahoof. Bash then demanded to throw a birthday party for Stereotype. Fighting a toddler on an idea would take more effort than just making up for lost productivity, so of course, a party would be thrown. Thank you. Sappho and Lazarus shared the news that the wheat harvest had just started with the rest of the Adlets at the party. Sappho promised Bash that soon he'd have a very special treat for him to try for the first time, something called bread. Bash was delighted that he'd have something other than slimy fungus to eat. Golden sheaths of wheat and strovers of mackie filled the fields of the farm. The abundance was truly staggering. Sappho and Lazarus wondered if it might be possible to only farm seasonally, retiring the Nutrifungus fields. But for now, it was safer to keep the fungal farms sown in case of shortages in the upcoming winter. Newly constructed shelves in the keep gave way to even more disorganization. Eventually, Sappho would find a rhythm to his daily duties in the kitchen, and the need for storing certain ingredients would hit a balanced equilibrium. But for now, chaos reigned supreme on the shelves, so Megahoof decided to keep at least the drinks and medicines separated for his own sanity. Sappho spun up the millstone for the first time, feeding a small sheath of wheat into the top to be ground into a powder. After grinding a few small batches, he agreed with the historical record wholeheartedly. While Madsy shoveled pollution from one of the air-looped battlements, she spotted figures converging upon the horizon. Her cries woke the other Adlets, who instinctively knew to grab their weapons, for soon they'd be fending off invaders. This raid was coming fast, and there was no time to waste. Madsy was thanked for her vigilance and told to go close the slab doors in the farm to make sure the invaders couldn't breach in. The gates had been shut, so the invaders surrounded the keep to search for weak points to breach inside. Madsy waded through the wheat rushing through the farm to pull the levers closing the slab doors. Lazarus propped open the front gate and stood as a bulwark, readied with a falchion and shield. Dave listened carefully for any sounds of breaching monsters, knowing they were searching the outskirts of the keep for weak points. After checking in all of the gates around the keep, Dave returned to the main door, ready to help the others defend the choke point. The Glade members had fended off the siege, but the faint smell of smoke filled the air, and the defenders knew that danger still loomed. Sappho quickly tended Lazarus's many bruises. Jadea hunted down the fleeing monsters while the others searched for the source of the smoke. The heavy slab doors of the gatehouse prevented the fleeing invaders from escaping. Jadea took the opportunity to shoot the retreating monsters dead. Dave and Oroko finally found the source of the smoke and worked to smother the blaze as best as they could. The offering pile of fungus had been set ablaze and fueled the small inferno. Jadea gently reminded the others the many corpses left within the walls of the keep would need to be hauled out to the marshes. Begrudgingly, the others obliged. Lazarus rested up, bruised and in pain from holding the door. Once he had the materials and time, he could forge additional suits of armor so the responsibility of Gate Warden wouldn't be his burden alone. Repairs to the gates were added to the ever-growing list needed to maintain their home in the glade. Between cleaning waves of smog and pollution and repelling skirmishing raid parties, it was truly a wonder that anything could be accomplished at all. Enough of the walls of the gatehouse had been constructed, and efforts could be shifted to finish the curtain wall. Soon, Megahoof would feel secure enough at home to set out in search of additional pollution-absorbing trees to study. Sappho carefully followed the directions for bread baking. He found baking to be wholly different from the cooking and stewing he was used to. When cooking either fish from the coast or fungus from the caves, a cook would spend time simmering the food to boil off excess moisture. Baking felt very foreign to Sappho. It was strange that he needed to add moisture to the flour to create the right consistency, and then fuel the oven to a specific temperature. Both of these factors were very poorly detailed in his recipes. Baking apprenticeships in the old Adlet kingdoms would have passed this knowledge down with hands-on and guided experience. But now Sappho was stuck learning from failure. His first batches were nearly inedible, but eventually he found the right formula and his efforts paid off in full. He couldn't wait to offer up bread to his other glade mates. The smell of newly baked bread was so enticing that awoke many sleeping adlets. Within an hour, in the middle of the night, the shelf of bread was bare. Having mostly recovered from his wounds, Lazarus realized one way to make it easier for him to defend the gates that wouldn't require iron would be to carefully craft superior bows so that the archers could quickly dispatch the monsters. He felt particularly inspired and started by selecting the finest cut timber for his project. Arelka looked on as Lazarus crafted well into the night and couldn't help but to think about how many animals he could hunt with such a well-crafted bow. Lazarus was so engrossed by his work, he barely even noticed he had company. Lazarus had crafted one of the finest bows that any of the archers had seen, even including Dave, who had spent time with many other marksmen. Lazarus left the bow on the workbench, figuring that one of the archers would grab it as their own. But consequently, none of the archers felt worthy of the weapon, so it sat there ornamentally. the first autumn morning was abuzz with activity. The smelter was roaring, full of iron mined from subterranean mine tunnels. The curtain wall was nearly completed, with just a few sections remaining. Piles of maki and wheat were left out, yet to be hauled in by already overworked adlets. The pace of industry and progress required to survive the hostility of the glade exceeded the norm for adlet culture. Adlets were creatures of slow-paced routines and well-established traditions. For most adlets, the ideal day would be waking up to a sun nearing its apex, only to sluggishly dawdle through a menial workday, which concludes well before dusk for time with friends and family. Urgency was a rarity, and complacency was commonplace. The adlets of the glade were spurred on with an inner fire of survival, and the passion seemed contagious as every new member felt equally inspired to contribute. One such menial task that each and every adlet could happily do without was the constant need for collecting and cleaning pollution. The cyclical task was maddening. It felt like they were trying to shovel water out of the ocean. They were in an invisible fight with the forces of nature, and it was difficult to gauge who or what was winning. If the incredible amount of labor to ensure the keep remained habitable wasn't bad enough, the smell of ores and coal coated in pollution burning in the hearths and stoves gave off a noxious aroma. Sometimes it was so bad that it would sting the adlet's eyes, just like when the smog rolled in. The smell would stick to their furs and clothing. The pollution permeated every facet of their lives and wore them down. With multiple batches of bread under his belt, Sappho wanted to experiment in the kitchen and whip up some meals he thought the others would enjoy. He wondered if the sweet pulp of pumpkin could be mixed with flour and possibly fried up with some of the oils left over from the millstone. The meal was a little more involved than just bread alone, and didn't help to stretch their provisions, but since food wasn't scarce, he decided to try out his idea. Halfway through planning, he realized his shelves were full of unprocessed hops, and the latest batch of ales had finished, so he tabled his concept for pumpkin fritters and headed over to the brewing station instead. Several projects were nearing completion. The months-long construction of a curtain wall had only a day left of work, and almost all of the iron for the windmill project had finished smelting. The adlets sensed change in the air, and unfortunately, their predictions would turn out true. Smog. Of course it was smog. Every possible milestone or celebration of success that had ever happened in the keep was met with a stark reminder of the fragility of their life in the glade. But today, Megahoof would embark outside of the glade to search for answers. Megahoof made some preparations before his departure. He wanted to inspect his food and the security of the keep walls before setting out in search of other pollution-absorbing trees. Megahoof told the other adlets he planned to take two bison and set off heading westward while staying within the Gutraro forest. If everything went according to plan, he'd be back in just a day or two, but if he wasn't back in three, then they should worry. He laughed to ease the thought of him not returning, but nobody within earshot received it as a joke. Megahoof bid his wife and child farewell and asked Lazarus and Sappho to look over them. He also asked to borrow a few of Lazarus's tools that he'd need, and then set off westward into the dense, noxious smog. Just as soon as Megahoof departed, a new sprouting of ambrosia cropped up in the southern fields. Through a mix of acidic lung burning and eye-watering smog, and knowing Megahoof was alone in the woods surrounded by raiding parties escorted only by two bison, the anxiety of the situation brought about an uneasy atmosphere that lingered within the keep. The keep was also slowly being suffocated by the encroaching blight, and the Adlets did everything they could to keep it at bay. Sappho realized it was the perfect time to unveil his newest concoction, pumpkin fritters. The warm, crispy comfort of the pan-seared flapjacks was well received. After a half-day's journey, Megahoof managed to find other clusters of pollution-absorbing trees out in the Cotrero forest. This meant that not only were the trees not an isolated mutation, but he could experiment on the trees without jeopardizing the sanctity of their own glade. He also spotted several large beehives, one surrounded by giant mutated gray-colored wasps and the other dormant and golden. He knew of beekeeping and apiaries from the research into ales and beers, and would absolutely try to bring home a piece of the hive to start the glade's first skep. He set about cutting a slab out of the salix tree, a name he brainstormed during his short journey. One of the botany journals had diagrams of trees that vaguely resembled the pollution-absorbing tree, and it had been classified as a type of salix. Megahoof unpacked the tools he borrowed from Lazarus and proceeded to cut into the bark of the tree, making careful observations, taking samples, drawing diagrams, and scrawling copious notes. There was so much to learn about the secrets of the salix tree, and his work seemed like the key to the long-term survival of not only him and his friends and family, but possibly the entire Adlet race. One benefit to having sturdy walls and doors to protect your community is it can take a lot of damage before raiders breach. The downside? When those raiders fail to breach, you still have to repair the impressive walls, and it takes an impressive amount of time. As Megahoof slowly dissected the tree's inner core, he noticed the strange giant hornets on his flank. It was very difficult to make careful scientific observations while also imagining being impaled by giant venomous stingers. Megahoof finished cutting a cross-section slab from the base trunk of the Salix for further study back at the keep. Before he'd pack up the bison and return to the keep, he'd harvest some of the honeycomb from the golden hive in hopes to start beekeeping back in the glade. He also would have to thank Sappho. The packaged rations and preserved maki were fulfilling and easy to pack. Now it was time to return home with the slab in hand. The overworked adlets almost failed to notice that their maki were left rotting in the field. Before Megahoof returned home, they wanted to rally everyone to help haul the wilting crops to be properly stored in the keep and pantry. Megahoof was returning home, back to the Bison Glade, with now a Salix slab in tow to research. Thank you for watching episode 12 of Hedge Knight's Salix. If you would like to support me as a content creator, please consider liking, subscribing, and sharing this with your friends. If you would like to become one of my Patreon patrons, a link can be found in the description of this video, as well as a link to Discord if you would like to join my gaming community. Thank you so very much for watching, and a special thank you to my Patreon patrons, Twitch subscribers, and viewers like you that support my channel and watched all the way up until the credits. Thank you so very much. Hope to catch you next episode. Farewell, my fellow adlets.